Bienvenidas y bienvenidos a un nuevo capítulo de Contravía. Soy Diego Aretz, estamos en el Hey Festival y iremos a hablar con personajes interesantes, personajes que nos van a contar historias, nos van a cambiar nuestra manera de ver el mundo. Y bueno, estamos hoy con Jean-Christophe Ruffin. Jean-Christophe, antes de iniciar la entrevista, quiero presentarlo. Es uno de los, digamos, defensores de derechos humanos más importantes del mundo. Él fue uno de los miembros importantes de Médicos Sin Fronteras. Es un novelista. Y vino aquí al festival a hablar de su vida, a hablar de su trabajo, a hablar de la importancia de la medicina como una ciencia social y también de cuál es el rol de los derechos humanos hoy en el 2019. Jean-Christophe, welcome to Contravía.
Thank you.
My first question is, how she arrived a country like Colombia that has a long history of conflict, and you can hear it to speak, and you can hear it to change your voice, to change your life. What was that for you?
Well, it's a great experience because it's my first time here in Colombia. I'm more familiar with Brazil and other parts of the continent. But as a model, I should say, model or anti-model, Colombia can show the different problems of human rights in this region, and it's very interesting to experience on the ground, I should say. I'm here for 2 weeks, but it's short, but I met too many people, and that gave me occasion to have a better knowledge of the situation and of the history of this country.
Right now in the world we see movements, right movements that have a lot of populism involved. We see in Germany how the right is gaining power. We see the government of Trump building this big wall in Mexico. And what is this kind of wall for a human rights activist?
Well, we had a very interesting talk in the Estanado Universidad a Bogotá last week about this problem of populism. It is true that we are at a turning point, especially in Europe, because for a long time we have considered that Europe was a kind of peaceful area, and now we realize that inside this block of countries there are different perceptions of what's the identity of Europe. For some people, like for instance in France, the building of the nation was always open. I mean, we have a tradition of receiving so many kind of different people. Also, the colonial history has given us the experience of different continents, different languages and areas. But in the east of Europe today, in Hungary, in Austria, in Slovakia, in these countries, Poland, their perception of the world is more defensive. I mean, they are considering that their identity has to be protected against anyone, and it splits completely the Europe today between two groups. You know, those who still are open, you know, and accept the ideas of an open world, and those who really want to build identity, and it's the same process in Brazil, it's the same process in the United States with Trump. I mean, there is a strong today gap between these, you know, the increasing gap between these two positions.
If you see the history of Europe, as you say it, and we can go back to the 50s where the European Union was like not even exist, but we have all these, you know, a new world of countries that live together and had a different view of international relations. Why do you think now we have this crisis? Why do you think now is happening this crisis?
I think we've made some mistakes in the recent past. Especially with the regarding what is going on in the Middle East and in Libya and such kind of place, we have let wars and very tough regimes for instance, in Syria. And this had very strong consequences on the civilian populations. So Europe was suddenly confronted to a strong movement of refugees and of migrants. So this has hit the continent very strongly. I mean, the problem of the migration has always been there, but at a slow pace. And suddenly it has increased because hundreds of thousand people were knocking the door, you know. And this has created a shock in the mentalities, and it has shown a different attitude. For instance, Hungary has built a wall, you know. Italy has gone to a very strange alliance between the extreme right and the, I should say, extreme left. It's not the case, but Cinque Stelle, a Spanish party. We feel that tension, and I think that France is maybe one of the last country who defends this conception of an open identity, and this is really a turning point.
When we see France now and we see the Yellow Velvets movement, how we read that? I mean, we're in Latin America, and how we should read this in a developed society? I don't like the term developed, but let's say developed society.
Yes, it's part of the problem. It means that the perception of the globalization inside a country like France is not the same everywhere. I mean, you have different perceptions. We have the winners of the globalization who consider that we should carry on in that direction with the building a common Europe and opening the world and be open to the others. And on the other side, you have people who feel themselves as the losers of that process. Low middle classes who have a strong nostalgia of the past, you know, and idealize the past, thinking that in the past it was better. It's a movement which comes from long, you know, but it blows up today, probably because President Macron has really been identified to this winners group. You know, he's young, he's talented, he's rich, he had been a banker, yes, you know. And so for many others, they have the feeling that they are not represented by such a man. And it's a strong, it's a moment they will reject the whole system, you know. They don't want any, don't have any trust in the political system, and they want to be the people, and that's why they ask for a referendum, for everything, you know. One of the most demand they have, the strongest demand, it is to have a referendum. It means we don't trust a politician to decide on our own, for us, on our sake. We want to vote for everything. I mean, you want to be, and this is very dangerous because the referendum and the people probably would change completely things. For instance, let's take an example. Death penalty, for instance. Death penalty, if you were, you know, and if you look at the polls of today, if you would ask to the people to vote on the death penalty, they would say yes. No, it's very dangerous because it's the door open to all kind of demagogy and populism.
When you say the winners of globalization, I think a lot about this problem with the other. You're a writer. You write about people. Have you lived in Africa and many other countries? And I want to talk about this. How is to live in a post-colonial world in which, by the way, France and Africa had all these relations? And how has that been for you? What has that been for you?
Well, it's, you know, I've experienced something quite difficult. I've been ambassador of my country in Senegal. It's our biggest embassy in Africa. And that was a former colony. So I was representing the colonial power in Africa. So this, I think, is the most difficult thing that you can imagine, because you have to create, to build a future on a very dramatic past, you know. So I think this gives me a certain confidence in the possibility that we have to integrate, I mean, this past. I mean, this it's a chance also to have this relationship with these countries. I mean, we share a language, for instance. We speak, all of these countries that speak French. We share a history, we share values, you know, in terms of political and human rights values. I mean, so I think we have to make a kind of selection, I should say, in that dramatic colonial heritage, and take what is good, you know, and there are things very good, and try to deal with which was the most difficult things. But it's a chance, really it's a chance, and I don't see this history as something which we should hide or we should forget. No, we should assume that and go beyond, you know, and go further with that.
How are the actual relations with Africa, France, Africa? How do you see the actual relations?
I think we have changed in the sense that for a long time, you know, there was a kind of paternalism. The relationship was almost exclusively with our former colonies, for instance, every year there was a summit between France and Africa, but it was only with the former colonies, you know, French-speaking countries. Now we have broadened that perspective, and this summit is with the whole continent, and I think little by little we are trying to normalize the relation with that continent. We have a relationship with also Anglophone countries, you know, like South Africa or like Nigeria, which were not French colonies, but are very interesting and powerful countries in that continent. So we try to normalize. It's not the only a limited, you know, relation between the French-speaking family, I should say. We have a broader perspective. The second thing is that for a long time there were underground networks, you know, between France, La France Afrique, yes, with business and so many strange things, you know. And this was encouraged in the beginning after the decolonization by at that time with Charles de Gaulle and Chirac, and all there were, you know, it was a way to create a special relationship, strange, not very clear with these countries. And this is now more and more cut. I mean, this French relation. We have to really to build a normal relations with these countries throughout our diplomacy, I mean, normal diplomacy, not underground people who knock the door at night to just have normal diplomacy. And this, I think, is we are in a good way for that.
The last two questions, I want to ask you a question about you as a doctor. When we think of you, you were 25, you were 20 years old, you right now. And what would you say to your young person? What will you tell yourself if you could come back?
Well,
feel a doctor.
Yeah, it's you know, I don't regret at all to have chosen this profession, because I think it's the best way to understand the human being. And once you have a broad comprehension of your profession, if you are not limited to working in the hospital, so if you use that background to have an experience of the world, it's very rich. And I think it was very good. I mean, I don't imagine to have chosen another training, background. I couldn't imagine at that time that the world would change so much. I was born in the time of the Cold War, you know. At that time we thought that Soviet Union would last for 1,000 years, you know. And we have experienced a complete change of the world. And it's fascinating, it's good, it's interesting. I wouldn't like to live another world.
My last question is about advocating for human rights. And we see a lot of wars happening. We see in Colombia, by the way, every day it's killed a human rights activist. And we see a lot of problems, a lot of, in Venezuela, migrants in Central America, in Mexico, disappearance, and a lot of stuff. And why to fight for? Why to keep fighting? I mean, when you can decide to be a doctor and live in France and just not worry about the rest, but you decide a completely different way of living, why to do that?
You know, I think medicine, if you think about it, it's not connected only with treating people, treating patients. It's a way of looking at the human being, trying to understand its condition, trying to improve this condition. Whatever the way you do it, you can do it by advocating human rights, you can do it by writing books, you can do it by giving medicine to the people, but there are different ways, you know. And me, long time ago, I had an experience when I was sent I was 25, you know, I was sent in Tunisia for my military service as a civil servant. And I was sent in a maternity, because it's French, and I discovered that there was not only in my job treating diseases, there was treating the whole person, you know. And today I'm confident in that. I think what we do is useful, you know. This should be repeated, because too many times when we talk, for instance, about Africa, there are people who say this continent will never, you know, survive, it's always in war, that's war. But it's not true. There are wars, there are problems, but not always at the same time. So I have seen wars raising and changing, you know. For instance, 10 years ago there was a civil war in Ivory Coast, there is no longer now. So things are improving, but other problems are raising another plot. But you have to keep confidence. It's not useful what we do.
Thanks for listening to me. Thank you, sir. Gracias a todos y a todas por estar conectados con Contravía. Nos vemos en un próximo capítulo. Y bueno, hasta la próxima.